Well, remember that always one of the things on the
like to welcome everybody tonight to the College and Complexes. My name is Tim. I'm going to be moderating tonight. College and Complexes consists of the following format. One, there'll be a brief announcements period. Second, we'll have our speaker who will speak up to about an hour. Third, we will then entertain a question and answer period with our speaker. And then fourth, we'll have our infamous rebuttal period. We will go to about 8:30 or so, or our speaker the last word about, I'm sorry, 7:30. Yeah. Restaurant closes at 8. So without further ado, we're going to get started with the announcements. And Charlie, take it away.
All right. Welcome, everyone, to meeting number 3,719 of the College of Complexes, the playground for people who think. And as always, I will recommend that you subscribe to, we have two email groups, one a Google group and the other one's a meetup group. It only takes a minute. You can do so in the center top of our website are the links. Once again, I would request that everyone in attendance in person, please be quiet. At least during the presentation, if the microphone does pick up this outside noise, and as well, if you're attending by Zoom, please put a red X over your microphone. Please do so now. And although I'm not a capitalist, I will give an advertisement for our upcoming programs. On June the 10th, Henry Kowalicz, an author of some renown. He's got 10 articles written on foreign affairs posted at the moment. And we're going to, the topic will be an update and a review of the Ukraine situation. Certainly one thing we need to discuss and look at carefully. So it's on the June the 10th, the Ukraine. Henrik comes from Eastern Europe, so he's got an edge on us in terms of the circumstances over there. On June the 17th, our own Andy Anderson will be talking, as he has in the past, on censored subjects. We're a free speech forum, so we have basically opposition to censorship of information. On June the 24th, we're having an academic expert. I'm quite glad we got him to speak, Dr. McPherson. Who get a report on the IPCC, the International Panel on Climate Change. We'll be discussing what we can do either as an individual or as a community to respond to climate change. That's on June the 24th. On July the 1st, yours truly, Charles Paddock, a social historian of sorts, but I will reporting on, all of you have seen these from time to time as you travel around our country, historical sites. And I, since in keeping with the fourth, this is the first of our 4th of July speakers, I will be speaking on what I determined to be my list of the 10 most important American heritage sites in the United States. You are invited to think about it and make suggestions if you have one or more sites that you think are preferable to those that I will indicate. But it's historic sites in the United States. I recommend, like, you could take your family if you have one. Okay, that's the first program. The second program attended to Independence Day, we have none other than George Washington himself. The big guy will be coming to the College of Complexes. The founding father himself. Talk about the early nation, conduct of the war, whatever, you can talk with him. Okay, that's on July the 8th. On July 15th, we're going to try something a little different. An open microphone. We're a month late. Juneteenth is the big date, but We're going to listen to a short recording, 20 minutes, of a letter written by Frederick Douglass about his reflections on slavery on the 10th anniversary that he had escaped to the North. As the letter he wrote to his former slave owner. And we'll open discussion and talk about the topic of slavery, prejudice, and so for prejudices against ethnic or racial groups, open it up. So this should be an interesting program. Our next, then, in the 22nd and 29th, they're open. If you've got a topic in you, I'd like to hear from you. I must have a title and a written description of the program ready to go in order to for me to confirm you speaking at the College of Complexes. On August the 5th, we will be joined again by another PhD academic, Jan Lee of our satellite campus, who's put together a program. She works rather assiduously at these on the rise of artificial intelligence. And she's going to talk about its challenges and its opportunity. There's some claims that it's just one big plagiarism machine. But please be quiet in the restaurant, folks. Thank you for your cooperation in this regard. At least three dates open in August. So if you've got a topic in you, I'd like to hear you again. There are ecological events this Wednesday at 1 o'clock if you want to support the Earth Bill passage. And on Thursday at 6, be a meeting of the Cook County Green Party. Thank you, sir. Take it away.
All right. I just also want to bring up our, we do have a Dallas campus that meets on Thursday nights. They're all completely on Zoom. The next thing is they're going to be doing an overview on a, they have an open up June 8th. They're still looking for speakers. But if you guys want to contact Tom Berry, that's another chance to join us on our live forum. Now, without further ado, I'm going to get back up front. And I would now like to introduce Charles Collins. Charles, we'll keep you at the restaurant while you're giving your presentation. You have up to about an hour. If you need the screen share, it should be working. But otherwise, let me introduce Charles Collins on tonight's topic. So Charles, take it away.
Hey, boy, Charles. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Greetings to everybody there at Dappers. Greetings from Brattleboro, Vermont. And actually, I'm just down the street from Guy McPherson, your speaker in a couple of weeks. So you got a couple of Vermonters coming to visit you in Chicago. I'm not going to talk for an hour. I think I'm looking forward to kind of conversation and hearing from you all. But let me just say, and I wonder if we could turn the restaurant sound off.
I'm going to do it now.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Tim. And thanks to Charles for inviting me and roping me in. So my day job is I work at the Institute for Policy Studies, which is kind of a progressive activist social change think tank based in Washington, D.C. But we've had a New England office for over a dozen years. And I direct a program on inequality and the common good. And I know a lot of your programs relate to issues of wealth inequality and class and economics. So check out inequality.org. That's the website I co-edit. And yeah, most of my day job is I look at, we just released a report about private jets and how private jets both burn up more emissions, but also, we as taxpayers subsidize private jets through the tax system. We look at the sort of kind of issues around billionaires and concentrations of wealth during the pandemic. We did monthly reports on how billionaire wealth was surging during the first 2 years of the pandemic. We look at the issue of CEO pay and the wage gap. And I've written a number of nonfiction books. 2 years ago, I did a book called The Wealth Hoarders, How Billionaires Pay Millions to Hide Trillions, about the wealth defense industry, the tax attorneys and wealth managers, family offices that help abet, enable the ultra wealthy to move their money offshore or to trusts or create, you know, fictional transactions, the whole bit. So another time, invite me back and I can talk sort of about that. But I really want to talk to you tonight about a new book that I've written. It's actually a novel, the first time I've written a novel. And I don't really, you know, aspire to be a fiction writer or join the literati and, you know, write novels. But I love the opportunity to kind of tell a good story, and a story that maybe can address the impasse, this moment that we're in, in terms of the climate crisis and disruption. The book is called Altar to an Erupting Sun, and it is, part of it is near fiction, near future, the next 7 years, and part of it is looking back over the last 40 years. And some of you may have read a book by Kim Stanley Robinson, the science fiction futurist writer, called Ministry for the Future, which looks at the next 40 years and sort of, you know, it's not like one of these dystopian Blade Runner, Mad Max kind of dystopian books. It actually talks about how humanity might begin to get our act together and turn the corner. So my book is kind of in that spirit. And in a nutshell, the story is about how a community based in New England, but it could really be anywhere. It could be in Illinois or Chicago or in Wisconsin, how a community faces the impossible news of sort of the ecological and political crisis that we're in. And looks at how can we reckon with this collision course, which is the fact that our political system seems incapable of responding to the political crisis because our political system has been captured, hijacked, taken over by the fossil fuel industries, their financial enablers, and a sort of capitalist system that basically keeps us locked on this trajectory toward either extinction or a really bad catastrophe, one or the other. So that's the story. And like fiction, you know, I try to tell a good story and develop characters. And my main character is a longtime activist named Ray Kelleher. Grew up in Southern Ohio, kind of the Appalachian, Eastern Ohio, Southeastern Ohio. Was the first person in her family to get a scholarship to go to Amherst College, but dropped out in 1973 because it just didn't make sense to her in that moment to be sitting there in a classroom when the Vietnam War was going on and there was a coup in Chile and all these things. So, and it's not a spoiler alert to say that the book begins. Ray is now in her 70s. She has a terminal illness, and she decides to take her own life and the life of the CEO of a fossil fuel company who she believes is responsible for delaying society's response to the climate crisis. So she goes out with this shocking, horrific act of violence. And the book then looks ahead 7 years at what the impact of her action has been. And her husband, a guy named Reggie Donahue, who's a longtime labor organizer, grew up in Dorchester. His father was a shipyard worker at Quincy Shipyard. He comes from a labor background. He, you know, when she mentions this to him in a kind of intimate moment where she says, look, I'm thinking of going out. I know I'm gonna die. I'm going to go out. This is how I want to go out. He says, that's a terrible idea. That may be cathartic for you, but it's going to have all kinds of negative blowback. It's going to hurt the movement. It's going to, lead to a crackdown in dissent and criminalization of protest, and it's really not going to help the cause. And 7 years later, he's looking back and thinking, you know, he was right. I mean, there's been this, over the next 7 years after her action, there's been this blowback, but there's also been kind of a rather amazing set of transformations as people begin to laser focus their attention on the role of this rogue fossil fuel industry in delaying, seeding denial, funding, sham science, using their wealth and power and lobbyists to keep us locked on a trajectory heading toward the cliff. And so that's the context. Then the question is, well, why did she do this? And she's somebody who grew up formed, shaped by nonviolent movements and by experiences both in Central America and the US, being part of the movement to shut down the School of Americas in Georgia, being part of a nonviolent campaign to try to stop a pipeline from being built. Whoever just joined, if you could put you on mute because it's kind of loud. So let me, so that's a good part of the book is sort of what led Ray Kelleher, this woman, to renounce her lifelong history, her lifelong commitment to sort of nonviolence and really tactically smart to engage in this shocking act of violence at the end of her life. And I'll talk about that, but unlike my nonfiction books that I have, I would never read from them. I think that would be tedious. I might want to just read a couple little sections to give you a flavor. And first, I just want to introduce you to Ray through the eyes of her partner, Reggie. And this is him looking back at Ray, looking back 7 years later, and they're all gathering for a memorial, kind of a birthday celebration, honoring her legacy. And he's thinking, you know, he's going to give a talk and people are going to want to hear what he has to say. So this is Reggie Donahue, the fictional husband of Ray Kelleher, reflecting about Ray. What can he say today about Ray that he hasn't already said before? Each year that goes by validates everything she predicted. She was prescient. She could see things that other people couldn't see. And she said he had that power too, if he wanted to tap into it. You see, Reggie knew he was going to lose her either way, either to the cancer that had metastasized through her body or her decision to go out with a violent bang. She could have ended her life here at Hidden River Farm, surrounded by loved ones. People could have sung songs to her as she had done with many others who had passed before. She could have gone gently to the other side. But no, not Ray. She was fueled by love, music, dancing, and rage, an anger so slow burn that it was chilling. Cold anger, as Reggie's old organizing friend, Ernesto Ernie Cortez, used to say, was what you looked for in a leader. The hot anger types would flame out, act impulsively, turn off allies. The cold anger types could strategize, build alliances, think long-term, and persist. It was Ray who convened the hospice and green burial ministry here at the Hidden River Farm. Many days he listened to her talk energetically about conscious dying, not letting the medical industry and the funeral profiteers get their talons into you. We need to speak about death, face it, accept it as part of the great cycle, she would say. She loved to point out the various death practices from indigenous and other cultures from around the world. We have so much to learn from these traditions. Reggie thinks about how every March, Ray enlisted him to join the salamander crossing teams that gathered along the roadways after the first warm spring rain. Wearing reflective vests and holding flashlights, they made sure that the frogs and salamanders, eager to attend wild spawning orgies in the vernal pools, made it across the road alive. Salamander protection required staying up to 11 p.m., several hours past Quaker midnight in Reggie's book. But nothing could deflate Ray more than holding a squished wood frog in her hand, knowing she could have saved a life, so he happily joined the crossing guards. So that's just a little flavor for Ray. And Ray, Reggie describes her kind of as a party in a box. Just add Guinness. She's a weaver of people and movements. And the story really tells about the things that shaped her, including real people. Now, there's a guy in the story, she meets Sam Lovejoy, who in real life topples a tower in protest of a nuclear power plant construction in Montague, Massachusetts. She meets Wally and Juanita Nelson, who were active in the Congress on Racial Equality, Black Back to the Landers, who became radical war tax resistors, apostles of nonviolence. Brian Wilson, not the singer of the Beach Boys, but Brian Wilson, who was a Vietnam vet, who became active in Vietnam Vets Against the War, and then took a leadership role in trying to prevent US intervention in Central America, lost his legs protesting at the Concord Naval Station in California when the United States was shipping weapons out of Concord Naval Station, putting them on ships and shipping them to El Salvador, where they were then airdropped to the Contras in Nicaragua. All these are real people who appear in this book. So those of you who've lived through some of those social movements will feel a connection to these stories in the same way they shaped you. They also shaped my main character, Ray. The other thing that I want to lift up in the story, I mentioned Ray's kind of interest in death and dying. And Ray becomes kind of a death doula. She works with people who are facing the end of their life. She helps them organize parties while they're still alive, on the theory that, you know, a lot of us go to funerals and you think, geez, wouldn't Teddy have loved this event? Wouldn't he love these stories? Why wait? let's sell. And for people particularly who are choosing physician-assisted suicide or choosing to go out without huge medical intervention, let's celebrate life while we still have our wits about us. So she's very active in that. And another part of this novel that I really wanted to lift up, and even in the chatter before the meeting, we were talking, I think Charlie or Tim were talking about the importance of healthy local economies, you know, and this idea that, you know, we would get our Caesar salad, all the ingredients would come on a plane from California or a train, when we could be producing more and more locally. And so in this book, I really lift up all the ways in which local communities are building local resilience, regional food systems, permanently affordable housing, creating local vibrant culture. The fact that you all get together every week for dinner and a conversation, as opposed to just, you know, sitting and, you know, watching social media, is part of a healthy, resilient local culture. So in this story, I kind of try to lift up and even project into the future some of what that looks like. Because part of how we're going to face the future, what I would consider to be this ecologically disrupted future, is by reweaving local communities of support, mutual aid, and meeting our basic needs, food and shelter and culture and livelihood. So for Ray and Reggie and the community that they live on, they really are thinking about being less dependent on sort of the global capitalist system and more delinking as much of their local economy. And I don't know a lot of fiction books that try to depict that and show what that looks like, and particularly how it plays out over the next 10 years. And I should say about the time frame of the book, I picked the next 7 years because, as you know, this is the critical decade. Humanity needs to get our act together here. If we continue on the same trajectory, business as usual, we're going to blow past the 1.5 degrees centigrade safety line, and we're more likely going to see the Earth's temperature rise 3 degrees centigrade, and that will lead to huge extinction events and potentially threaten survivability for humans and other creatures. So this isn't a joke. We really, as Ray says, and many of you have heard, we're the first generation that can really fully grasp the consequences of climate change and climate disruption. And we're the last generation that is going to really be able to do anything about it. So that's a lot of my urgency in telling a story that shows how people survive. And I'm not going to talk much about altars. Actually, when I've done in-person books, I actually bring an altar that I've created that has some of the characters in the story, some of the real life people in the story. But Ray is an altar builder, and the theme of altars kind of goes through the whole story. And I'll tell one actual true story from the book that I report out. I mentioned Brian Wilson. I think I saw Steve Grossman nodding his head and knowingly that maybe he knew Brian Wilson or knew who he was. Brian Wilson I knew him. He lived down the road in Greenfield, Massachusetts. He was obsessed with a guy named Norman Morrison. When he went off to Vietnam, he had heard about Norman Morrison. Norman Morrison, turns out, went to the same high school, Chautauqua High School in upstate New York, that Brian Wilson went to. And Norman Morrison, a Quaker from Baltimore, in 1965, self-immolated himself at the Pentagon outside Robert McNamara, Secretary of Defense McNamara's office. And he did that in the spirit of the Vietnamese monks who also immolated themselves in protest of the war in Vietnam. And he was obviously protesting the war in Vietnam. And of course, we learn many years later that in the documentary, The Fog of War, about McNamara, where McNamara says something to the effect of that, that guy, Norman Morrison, I can't get him out of my head. That his witness pierced Robert McNamara's psyche. Anyways, Brian Wilson, in Vietnam, one of his jobs was he had to go into villages after the US bombing raids had come through to see the impact of the bombing raids. So he goes into this village, and of course, it's supposedly a Viet Cong stronghold, but in fact, all they find are women and children and old people. And he goes and there's a hut, and he enters the hut, and there's an altar with the candles are still burning on the hut. And in many traditions, you know about Day of the Dead in Mexico and others where people build altars. But in Vietnam, people also have altars of remembrance and have pictures or icons of their ancestors on this altar. So he goes up and there's this altar and the candles are burning. And there are these Vietnamese ancestors. And there is a picture of Norman Morrison. And again, Brian Wilson is like, Norman Morrison is on an altar in Vietnam. The guy I went to high school with, the guy who was the Eagle Scout I looked up to. So Brian Wilson was very, very affected by Norman Morrison and essentially had an altar in his house with this picture of Norman Morrison. So, and Ray, like a lot of us in the 1980s, was involved in trying to keep the United States from, invading Nicaragua and overthrowing the Sandinista government and, stop meddling in El Salvador. And so Ray Kelleher, my main character, also goes to Central America. And I don't know if some of you had that experience, but whether you went for a month to pick coffee or cotton or whether you worked there for a year, it was a very formative experience for a whole generation of activists and people. Gave us, and I speak personally, a sense that, you know, there's a whole other world out there, and a visceral understanding of U.S. foreign policy. So again, Ray is visiting El Salvador, and she is working in a refugee camp called Bethany, outside the city. And it's full of about 4,000 people who've been displaced from the conflicted zones in El Salvador. There's a civil war going on, but basically the Salvadoran army with U.S. backing is burning down villages sympathetic to the insurgent FMLN. And so all these people are in this refugee camp, 4,000 people wedged into a camp that maybe is built for 2,000 people. And she's getting oriented, and she meets a woman named Chepa, who is a midwife. And when you have a refugee camp with 4,000 people in it, there's probably like anywhere from 3 to 5 babies being born every day. And there are doctors from, you know, French doctors from Doctors Without Borders who come in 2 or 3 days a week and work at the clinic there. But the rest of the time, the Salvadoran midwives are running the show. And even the European doctors look at this woman, Chepa, and think she knows how to deliver complicated births without advanced machinery. So even when they have a breech birth in the Bethany camp, Chepa, they call Chepa in. But so at one point, Ray is invited by Chepa. I'll just read this one little part again on the theme of altars. One day, Chepa invites Ray to visit her family cubicle and see her altar. Amidst the chaos and bustle of life in the camp, Chepa has created a sacred space on a shelf in the corner of a single room shared by 6. On her altar are several burning candles, devotional statues, and a dozen photographs. Ray recognizes Archbishop Oscar Romero. With few flowers anywhere near the camp, she's placed freshly flowers and leaves with the smell of ash and other herbs. She points to the voter identification card of a young man. "This is my son Ramon," she says in Spanish. "He was assassinated by the army." "Oh God, I'm so sorry," Ray responds, squinting at a postage stamp-sized photo. "And this is my husband Raul," Chepa says, pointing to a blurry photo of a man holding a machete. "He was killed in the conflict." With her voice steady and tears clouding her eyes, she introduces Ray to her universe of loved ones, many of whom have died and suffered in the war. "Mi altar es mi fuente," my altar is my source, she says, letting the sentence hang in the air. Ray understands her meaning. This altar is where Chepa can grieve, but it is also the source of her spirit to live and to accompany mothers bringing children into the world. She has endured massive loss, her loved ones, her home, yet Ray feels how Chepa pulls toward life. And as Ray is returning back to the United States after her 6 months working in El Salvador and Central America, she says, you know, she's filled with gratitude for the life she has back in New England. She has a job to return to and abundant food and loved ones at home. Ray gently handles her blue U.S. passport, thinking of all the privilege and power that goes with it. More important, Ray now has an inner knowledge that no matter how hard things might get, she can always build an altar with the photo she can salvage and draw strength from it. So that theme of altars is part of a theme in the story. But let me just maybe use the last part of my talk to talk about sort of the themes of violence and nonviolence that sort of emerge in the story. And, you know, one of my desires and hopes was to talk about what are we going to do in the face of this moment that we're in. And the way I've described it, and again, part of the chatter, Tim and Charlie at the beginning were talking about this new Mountain Valley project that just got approved now. What is this? This is as part of the debt ceiling negotiations where the Republicans basically have held the world hostage, held the U.S. hostage with their kind of austerity agenda, basically. One of the things that was part of the negotiation, as part of the final deal is the approval of this Mountain Valley Pipeline. It's Joe Manchin's pet project, bringing fracked natural gas from West Virginia to Virginia. And as part of that debt ceiling deal, they created a shield against any lawsuits that might delay construction of this pipeline. So even in this moment where the focus is on deficit reduction or whatever, the fossil fuel industry is ramming through one of their priorities. And that's just to give pause that, you know, in this moment, when we know and the science tells us that we should rapidly be transitioning away from oil, coal, and natural gas. Natural gas is not a bridge fuel. It burns methane, which concentrates more heat in the atmosphere in the short term than carbon. We should not be building new fossil fuel infrastructure for future extraction projects. And yet, you know, as we all are sitting here at Dapper's restaurant and talking on Zoom, the leaders of the fossil fuel industry are pushing to build more infrastructure to extract more carbon. There are 195 carbon bomb projects, each which would emit 1 billion tons of carbon over 10 years. And if half of them get built, we will blow past any livable limits. So there's a big debate, I think, in the climate change world and in the United States and over who is responsible for this predicament we're in. You know, is it all of us? Because particularly all of us who are middle class or affluent in the United States with our high standard of living. Is it a few people, the fossil fuel industry? Is it us? Is it them? What's, you know? And Ray Kelleher, my main character, part of the story is that following the evolution of her deepening understanding about the causes of our current predicament. So, you know, 20 years ago, she, coming back from Central America, she's saying, we consume so much. Those of us, I'm hearing an echo, so whatever. Anyway, those of us who are, you know, we're all responsible. We all have a big carbon footprint. You know, did you drive your car to the store when you could have walked or taken public transit? Did you take a plane when you could have taken a train? You know, what's your carbon footprint? That's sort of the conversation. And Ray would agree, say, well, yeah, we're, you know, you want to understand the seeds of violence, the first thing you do is look at your own life, your own lifestyle, and the ways in which, as John Woolman would say, you have the seeds of violence in the way that you live. So Ray would support that. But as she develops as a political activist, going into, say, 10 years ago, 2012 or 2013, there's a move to construct a pipeline through her neighborhood in Boston. And the purpose of this pipeline is to bring fracked natural gas from Pennsylvania up the New England seaboard, bring it into Boston, ostensibly to meet Boston's gas needs, but then move it to export terminals so the gas can be turned into liquefied natural gas and exported to Europe. And even, you know, 6-7 years ago, people understood there was going to be this geopolitical conflict between, you know, Putin and Gazprom and Russian natural gas and U.S. natural gas. So she, you know, basically is participating in this effort to stop this pipeline, and they basically get rolled. I mean, they have hundreds of people doing civil disobedience, but they basically can't stop it. And in that process, she really understands, oh, there's this thing called FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, that is the federal, you know, agency that oversees pipeline approval. And they're basically kind of a revolving door with the industry that they supposedly regulate. and they rubber stamp proposals, and they've never, you know, out of 400 gas pipeline proposals, they've approved 398 or something like that. She begins to sort of understand like the fix is on here. And she's even thrown out for no good meeting. She's thrown out of a meeting, and she realized this is, I'm seeing that the fist, the authoritarian fist of US energy policy. And then she starts to read the science and the information about, you know, Exxon and Shell and all these corporations. They knew 40 years ago the harms that would be caused by climate change. But they used, the industry used their power to fund denial. There's no such thing as human-caused climate change. Think about the decades that we have squandered just debating whether or not climate change exists and whether humans cause it. Funding, sowing doubt, funding sham science. You know, she reads the book Masters of Merchants of Doubt, you know, about the industries that both, you know, confound whether it's tobacco or climate change. This, they're just out there to sow doubt. How they use their power to block alternatives, you know, higher fuel standards or solar transition, right up to today. These industries are making sure that certain things are not on the menu. Those of you at Dappers, there's certain things that are not on the menu tonight and some things that are. And their job is to basically say, you got coal, gas, and, you know, oil on the menu. We don't have other alternatives. And that has been true for decades. So Ray kind of does the deep dive. And that's how she learned. She does deep dive. So I want to share, just read a little bit about her state of mind as she comes toward the end of her life. And those of you who come out to Western Massachusetts sometime, there's a great little bookstore in this town of Montague called the Book Mill. Its motto is, books you don't need in a place you can't find. And it's a favorite place of theirs to go. So Ray and Reggie, they do this, they have a favorite bike ride kind of near where they had their first kiss, their first real date. So they go to the Book Mill. I'll just read a little bit. And the other thing I should tell you is, so Reggie, I mentioned, is a labor organizer. He's now working with a group called the Labor Network for Sustainability, which is a real group that works with trade unions on promoting a just transition, making sure that workers don't bear the burdens of transitioning to a clean energy economy. In fact, that good jobs are in that sector. So that, just to context, that's the work he does. So they get to the Book Mill, and Reggie wanders around while Ray orders a plate of cold peanut sesame noodles and an iced tea, and she sits at the outdoor table. The tumbling water provides a solid state background noise to her reading. She's on one of her relentless learning immersions, this time focused on the fossil fuel industry and its role in blocking solutions to climate change. Over the pandemic, she's had video dates with several friends of Reggie's who are investigative journalists and documentary filmmakers. She has read the lawsuit briefs filed by citizens groups against oil and gas companies for failing to protect the public. They all detail the tactics of the oil and gas industry in deflecting any limits to production. In the previous week, Ray and Reggie watch a three-part frontline documentary, The Power of Big Oil. And now she pulls out her Guardian Weekly with a special investigation on carbon bombs, which she actively reads, pen in hand. Reggie finally joins Ray. He sets down three book purchases and a glass of hard cider on the table. Basically, these oil and gas companies are betting against humanity. Ray waves a fork in the air. They are incapable of stopping themselves. She points at what she's reading and says to Reggie, okay, so you have the Secretary General of the United Nations saying that if we don't cut fossil fuel use, we will, quote, miss our chance to secure a livable and sustainable future. And you've got big oil and gas investing in 195 projects that will each release at least a billion tons of carbon emissions, what they call carbon bombs. Reggie knows this picture, but the new data is still stunning. Wow, he says. Well, our job is to make sure those become stranded assets, that their carbon holdings remain in the ground and all that infrastructure and equipment becomes useless. What a waste. Ray puts her fork down, putting her hands in her lap and leaning toward Reggie so their foreheads are almost touching. Yeah, well, these carbon barons are betting that your effort will fail, that they will succeed in buying off the global politicians long enough to burn and extract and make a profit. I hope that pisses you off. Now, again, she's saying this to her husband, who this is his work, right? Ray, that's my job, to stay pissed. Reggie doesn't say anything more in response to her provocation. He's been watching with concern as she is more impatient and righteous and sometimes even hurtful to the people she loves. Recently, she stood up at a local talk about beavers and criticized the analytical shortcomings of the young speaker. And she's been yelling on the phone and hanging up on her brother, Toby, and using the F word more and more frequently, right? She's a nice Catholic girl. She doesn't use the F word, but now, for whatever reason, now she's... Reggie focuses on Ray, watching her as well as listening. She's more agitated than passionate. He swears he sees a flicker of fear in her eyes, not her usual slow-burning fire. Or is it the flavor of rage that he is unaccustomed to? You are with someone for 36 years, he thinks, but there is still some uncharted territory in there. Ray notices his look. They exchange a silent glance. You think I've gone off the deep end, eh? It just looks like your celebrated cold fission anger is hot and heading toward the meltdown zone. Yeah, you may be right about that. Ray pauses before making a confession. I feel something off kilter in my body, in my gut. And that's just a preview that she's sick. She's learning that she's at a very, very advanced stage of sickness. And let me just read one last section as we turn to your questions and thoughts. So Ray mentions to Reggie, as I mentioned earlier, that she's thinking of this, committing this shocking act. She says, I'm thinking I'm going to take my own life, but I'm going to take out the CEO of an oil company. She's picked a target. She's researched it. And Reggie's like, this is a terrible idea. Don't do it. And she says, I'm not going to talk about it anymore. I don't want to implicate you. You didn't hear it from me. And so then the next day, Reggie says, look, I do want to talk about it. Maybe we could talk about it in an abstract way. Can we organize a little, what the Quakers call a clearness committee? Can we pick a trusted group and have a conversation about tactics and nonviolence? And she agrees to that, and they bring in their sort of adopted daughter and a very close friend. And they drive off, they go off the grid, they go up onto this mountain, they leave their cell phones in the truck glove compartment, they bring a few folding chairs out and they sit on this ridge and they have it out. And they are, and I won't read that whole section, but for those of you who are interested in sort of debates around tactics and nonviolence, they have it out. And pretty late, you know, and part of it's important for Reggie and Ray to be able to have this disagreement and work it out. So at one point, you know, they've talked it through, and Reggie says, what about doing a Norman Morrison in the lobby of Shell or ExxonMobil? A sacrificial act, not a murder, says Reggie. So again, I mentioned earlier who Norman Morrison is. So he's basically saying, instead of murder, do something bold and powerful and witness, but don't take other lives, which will have negative repercussion. And Alex, their daughter, says, who's Norman Morrison? And quickly they explain, he was a pacifist who set himself on fire in protest of the Vietnam War. It had a big impact, including on Secretary of War Robert McNamara. And Ray basically, she says, that's the old nonviolent credo. Draw suffering upon oneself. That's like Gandhi in the Salt March, Martin Luther King at Selma. I get that. I've lived my entire life and I've thought about that, but I think we're past that point. We're talking about a couple dozen powerful people who have wrecked the planet because of their own greed. And they are actively doing more damage now. And they're actively blocking the efforts of the rest of humanity to avert disaster as we sit here. They're betting that we won't get our act together in time to stop them. They are hoping we will go to lots of climate grief workshops and sit around crying about our lost futures, boo-hoo for our grandchildren. The oil barons are building their bunkers and private jet landing strips. Well, fuck them. Is our society going to stand by and let them destroy the earth? The three others pause again, taking in the intensity of Ray's convictions. Ray's hands are shaking in fury. Bring more suffering on ourselves? I know that theory of nonviolence, and there are plenty of scenarios where I would agree with it morally and tactically. But let's say we live in a neighborhood, and every week some arsonist shows up and burns down another neighbor's house. Should we all sit around and sing dirges and pass the Kleenex? Boo-hoo, there goes another house. How can we nonviolently stop the arsonist? Appeal to their fucking humanity? The asshole is burning down our neighborhood. Are we just going to sit there and take it? Should we set ourselves on fire? Now, what if the arsonist controls the whole system? They can even turn off the fire hydrants. They even deny there are fires, and they can block all our nonviolent efforts. Well, guess what? That's where we're at. So let me close by just saying I think, and I predict in this, and I write in a fictional way about the next 7 years and what I envision as an escalation of tactics. And that includes people, you know, like Extinction Rebellion or climate defiance, doing more public witnesses, you know, blocking roads and things like that to draw attention to the climate crisis. You see that in Europe, where there's an escalation of tactics. I think there will be property destruction. You know, there's a new film out, dramatic film called How to Blow Up a Pipeline, which is actually, I recommend it. It's a very good dramatic film. It's now, you can stream it. So that, you know, sabotage, eco-sabotage. There are sacrificial acts like the Norman Morrison. So a year ago, Earth Day, a man named Wynn Bruce, 50-year-old man from Boulder, Colorado, on Earth Day, self-immolated on the steps of the Supreme Court as the High Court was considering weakening legislation to regulate climate change. And then there are people like Ray who would say, who is steeped in, would say it's a Bonhoeffer moment. She's steeped in the teachings of the German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was a pacifist, but then made this decision to participate in a plot to assassinate Hitler, and he was executed when he was caught. So this escalation of direct action, I believe, and I sort of depict it in the book, at one point after, inspired in part by Ray's witness, six grandmothers calling themselves the good ancestors immolate themselves in the lobby of ExxonMobil. And this brings this attention and focus on the role of this particular industry, this rogue industry, in that process. So that I also sort of depict as part of how we turn the corner is there's going to be a rising militance of tactics, as well as a backlash. All the things that Reggie predicts happen, criminalization of dissent and repression, and the fossil fuel industry trying to become protected. But there are defectors and cracks in the system, and some CEOs renounce what their companies have done, and you can sort of see. So I kind of vision out and play out from a conversational point of view how things could unfold in the years to come. So anyway, thank you for listening, and I may be back to Tim as our fearless moderator. You can see people and yeah. Look forward to your thoughts. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to ask everybody now to, it's now our question and answer time. And I've got one question for our speaker. What do you see as the solution to climate change? Is it just your direct action against fossil fuel companies? Or have you even tried to look for some kind of solution to it? And if so, I'd like to hear about it, what your thoughts are on that.
Well, there's a lot of things we need to do. I would say maybe the things you haven't heard about are we should explore. Here's our problem. We have a political system. Think about Congress in Washington right now. They're approving the Mountain View pipeline project as part of a debt ceiling deal. They're completely incapable of responding to the challenges of the moment. So we need obviously a radical change in politics. So actually direct action aimed at preventing new fossil fuel infrastructure is really important. And some of you mentioned the E5, the pipeline being built across the Mackinac Straits. I grew up in Northern Michigan, so that's close. So there's a divestment movement, which is important in that it is moving capital. And at last looked, there's $40 trillion of pledges, religious denominations, unions, universities, pledging to take capital out of investments in fossil fuel and move it to the clean energy economy, and in the process, revoking the social license. But I guess what I would like to see is people understand this industry regard them in the same way we think of like drug cartels and narco traffickers. They're powerful criminal syndicates that use their power to block reforms and alternatives. We should expose the politicians that accept money from these industries. We should look at ways to nationalize or create public authorities to acquire fossil fuel assets and keep them from being burned. On Tuesday, I have an article coming out in The Hill, the Capitol Hill newspaper, calling for the formation of a congressional climate tribunal to investigate the role of the fossil fuel industry in kind of locking us in to the current trajectory. So that's not to say individual behavior doesn't matter. What each of us does, how we kind of reduce our own consumption, our individual behavior matters, but that's not gonna stop the rising tide. That's, you know, there are deeper system problems here that need to be addressed. So reducing energy consumption is important. Stopping new fossil fuel infrastructure, making sure that these carbon assets that are currently being extracted, you know, new infrastructure does not get built. Moving capital out of those sectors, divesting from banks that are the financial enablers of these projects, TD North and all these banks that are. So I think those are a couple of the things, and I'm sure other people here are part of. You know, where I live, there's a big commuter airport for private jets just outside Boston, Hanscom Field. And right now there's a proposal to quadruple its capacity to handle private jets for the ultra wealthy are very popular among the super rich. They don't want to sit next to you or me on the airplane. They want to fly in their private jet. And this would be a carbon bomb, meaning if this airport is built and these jets, the number of jets expands to use it, it will release a billion tons of carbon emissions in 10 years. So we are mounting a mighty campaign to stop that airport expansion. But those are like examples of pressure points where we can make a difference. And I would say we can, you know, it's important. My friend Andrew Boyd has written a book called I Want a Better Catastrophe. It's kind of a funny title, but basically saying if the choice is between extinction or bad catastrophe, let's work toward the bad catastrophe or a better catastrophe. And that's where we're at.
Right. Okay. Chuck, right now I'm going to ask you in the next few questions. We got some people who are going to be wanting to ask if you can keep your responses a little bit shorter so that we can get allow for everybody to come in. Ernie, I know you've got your hand up, so you're next. And then we'll go to our people at Dappers here after that. Okay. So Ernie, go ahead, please.
Yes. My question is this. Can y'all hear me? I'm off mute. Good. I'm usually on mute. So good. My question is this. What role do you see as the extreme increase in population in the world playing in the problems we have in saving the environment? And what solutions do you have to this problem of the more people there are, obviously, the more people that are you know, burning fuels and doing other things consuming, which makes the planet weaker?
I don't think of population growth as a driver. It certainly is a driver of other ecological problems, you know, in terms of resource construction, you know. But here's what we know is that the biggest consumers of carbon and methane are affluent people in the global north. And that where population growth is, where population growth is the lowest, right? In the areas where there's like rapid population growth, those tend to be regions where there's less, where women have less control over their reproductive rights, and where, but where carbon emissions are nowhere near the level of, you know, so the people who live in the equator zones are the least burners of carbon emissions. They although they may be degrading ecosystems just to survive, cutting down trees, degrading soil, and all those things. So population is important. I don't think our planet can, you know, we're 8 billion climbing to 9 billion. You know, I think we need to look at things that actually create more financial security and empower women. That will bring population down around the world. I think we know that you know, this Earth can sustain, you know, 3-4 billion people well if we live within the Earth's boundaries, its limits in terms of water consumption and extraction. But we also know there are ways to grow food that don't require kind of the level of extraction that we currently have. So I guess I would say population isn't the driver. It's an important factor, but it's not the driver of the problem.
But isn't the per capita usage, the what you're calling the global north, the rich, isn't our per capita usage and contribution to the problem much, much higher, you know, on a per capita basis?
Yeah, those of us in the global north, absolutely.
Yes.
We're the ones that need to kind of clean up our act first.
Okay. Ellen, go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Can everybody hear Ellen real well?
Can you hear
Hi, Ellen.
I don't know if it's, I'm popping into the thing, but okay. Good. All right. Thank you. I'm Ellen Corley. I liked your book and your talk and your topic. I guess my question is, you know.
Cannot hear Ellen.
You can't hear?
Just get the microphone closer to you.
All right. Here, the question. Can you hear me now, Ernie?
A little better.
little better?
Louder, just speak louder.
Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, I'll try to be louder. I'd like to what do you think about, I've heard of the Institute of Policy Studies, and I'm wondering what more they're doing, but my thought is that it's not, you know, he asked about the population. I think it's the supply side, that it's a criminal state. And, you know, you mentioned Romero, the Romero Institute is an interesting group. Do you think there's any hope in criminally prosecuting or changing the law, like a jurist, a Federalist Society, to prosecute corporations or regulate corporations, which are not people? And I also, you know, there's got to be some way to prosecute the censorship of topics, you know, at YouTube, not allowing topics.
All right, question.
To be put onto, to be discussed in an open way, like potentially an injection that's poisoning us, but we're not allowed to talk about. Thank you.
Okay, go ahead and answer the question.
I would just say, Ellen, you're right. We need there are lawsuits against corporations, but I think we should criminalize like fomenting false science, you know, things like that. That other countries, you can't just make science up and disseminate it without consequences. So yeah, I think going after the disinformation of the fossil fuel industry and criminalizing that, I think would be a really, really good step.
Okay, any follow up, Ellen, or not? Okay, Charlie, you're next.
Yeah, all right, sir. I'm a member of the IWW, the Industrial Workers of the World, as well as the field representative of a major union. In organizing capacity. And in disputes, we have an option of going on strike, seeking remedies through legal means, grievance, arbitration, mediation, or as the IWW advocates, engaging in acts of sabotage. I presume you are you advocating that I recommend to my bargaining unit that they engage in sabotage acts for resolution of disputes?
I mean, I would say we should be looking at, when we say sabotage, I mean, I think when I was a kid, there was some developer came into our neighborhood, and they were going to take this forest and they were going to build new roads and a subdivision. And this is the fields and forests that we played in and hunted in. And we pulled up those road stakes. I was an 8-year-old engaging in eco-sabotage, defending the earth. I think that's completely should be part of the discussion. And I recommend watching the film, How to Blow Up a Pipeline, which is a dramatic, not a documentary, a dramatic story about 8 young people. But also Andres Malm's book, How to Blow Up a Pipeline, which basically makes the case for bringing property destruction into discussions about climate tactics. So it's not popular. Now you see people throwing soup at paintings, you know, to get attention. It does, you know, it does get attention. But the IWW history of direct action and sabotage, there are situations where that will be required, I believe. Given that our other avenues for change are blocked right now, you can't call up your member of Congress and say, vote for the climate reform bill. Ain't going to happen, because for 40 years, the industry has hijacked our democracy. So we have to go outside those channels.
Quick follow up. Early on, many, many years ago, the animal rights community was engaged in nonviolent acts of civil disobedience, saving rabbits from laboratories, and the other action among the ecological community was things like pickaxe that were digging holes in logging roads and things like that. But there was enormous retaliation by the right-wing community identifying environmental people as dangerous. Wouldn't that have negative consequences, Charles? Thank you.
It all has potentially negative and unconstructive blowback. And that's actually one of the things in the book. So people are, you may be familiar with Edward Abbey's his novel called The Monkey Wrench Gang. And the whole idea of monkey wrenching is, and that led to the formation of Earth First, which then were branded as eco-terrorists. And people would say in the West that that movement set back the environmental movement. So, it's worth having that debate at this moment where we're at.
Okay, Jonathan, just stay right there and go ahead and ask your question.
Yeah, thanks, Chuck.
Louder.
Thank you, Chuck. It's an interesting talk. For the Sustainable Development Goals of the United Nations from 2015 agenda, number 16 on the list of goals is promote peaceful and inclusive societies for sustainable development, provide access to justice for all, build effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions at all levels. So my question goes on this premise. We, in theory, in the United States, have the freedom to peacefully assemble and petition the government for a list of grievances. During the Occupy Wall Street movement, that's exactly what our tactic was. And we found out very quickly that our public spaces are deemed by the powers to be not to be our spaces, which of course we disagree with in the strongest possible terms. In order to have real full societal structural change, you need everyone involved, you need all hands on deck. It literally need every community to stop what they're doing and focus on the main task, which is making the biosphere livable for everybody. So with your book's prediction, I guess, I'm still not 100% certain whether it's a prediction or you're just entertaining the nonfiction possibility for the sake of writing a book. We're going in a direction of non-peaceful mass mobilizing,
okay,
to petition the government for a list of our grievances. I think that's where we're headed from every organizer that I've seen there.
Get to your question, Jonathan, please.
Do you feel like you're in tune, in touch with that premise that we are on the verge of having massive, peaceful, democratic mass assemblies all over the world to say enough with the powers that we don't represent our principles, number one being the biosphere being livable for all?
Okay, go ahead and answer your question.
Yeah, great question. I think and this is future fiction, but I think what's going to happen is the climate crisis is going to get worse. We're going to experience it as droughts and freak storms and, disruptions of our life. And that will raise the stakes. And so then people will respond. And I do think there will be more peaceful assemblies, more pushing back. And I would say the key is act where we have agency, wherever we have. If we have local space, and a big part of the book is about how one community prepares. So we shouldn't just wait for the national and global political system to catch up here. We need to start preparing now for a disrupted future. What's the source of your feud? Who are your neighbors? How do we build mutual aid? How do we help each other survive, the storms of the future, if you will? So I do think the ecological moment will keep, the pressure will keep growing for us to respond. And in a sense, we're on a collision course between our failed political system and the consequences of climate change. And that will lead to this you know, kind of moment of truth, really, I think.
I appreciate that. As a quick follow-up, for your next book, can you possibly foresee one of the possibilities of being your interest talking about how people get more involved when they see movement politics, where they can bring their kids, their grandkids, their parents, their grandparents, make it a happening, make it a block party, make civics a dynamic part of our everyday lives, in order to tell the governments who have failed us that they are no longer representative of our values, we the people are, and therefore we peacefully and democratically take power in order to not wait for them, as you right.
Well said, thank you.
Future book idea. Chuck, thank you.
Okay, go ahead and answer the question. Okay. All right, Elaine, you got your hand up. Go ahead next. You're next.
Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Great. So my question is, would you see the possibility of the severe scaling down / elimination of animal agriculture without having to go full Stalinist pointing a rifle at people to stop eating meat? Animal agriculture is responsible for the lion's share of carbon emissions, the vast majority of nitrous oxide emissions, a significant amount of methane emissions. So generally, how do you see us going about eliminating or again severely curtailing the amount of animals we raise for food, basically? Thank you.
Yeah, great question. I do think that is part of the future of how do we live within the boundaries of the earth. We, you know, the middle class and affluent global lifestyle is great increases in meat consumption. You know, in a more sustainable way, people still might eat meat, but it would be as a, you know, like in a lot of Asian cultures, it's sort of flavoring. It's sort of an added protein. But we now know we can meet most of our protein needs without this vast animal husbandry industry. At a very local level, you know, if you're doing small scale agriculture, there's ways to integrate animals in. I live on a farm. We have, you know, poultry and livestock. We don't, you know, they're part of the system. Their waste is part of our fertilizer. It's a closed system, if you will. I think there are ways, and you know, we don't eat we rarely eat those animals. So, but they're part of the great cycle here. So, I think radically scaling back, certainly the kind of global meat sums and the way in which meat is produced through these large, you know, CAFO operations is part of how we're going to get there, for sure. Great question, an important point.
Oh, okay, Kyle, you're next on the thing. Answer. I'll lower your hand and you got the floor.
Hello, thank you. I was wondering if perhaps, Chuck, when it comes to just powering the overall grid, if you feel that all the energy should be from green energy, which would be solar and wind, or because of the intermittence of it, it's not always windy, it's not always sunny, if you're open to using other things such as, let's say, thorium energy, carbon capturing technology with things like natural gas, which produce far less carbon than coal, or if you feel that it should all be done through green energy.
Just on the gas point, I think it's important to realize, I said it briefly, but gas is not a bridge. Yes, it's better in terms of carbon emissions than coal, but it's worse in terms of methane emissions, which trap heat faster in the short term. So there's a certain greenwashing to the effect that gas should be included in the menu. We should, you know, gas is a fossil fuel, major contributor. You know, I think we should be careful about, I don't think we should be building new nuclear power plants. but we should be carefully stewarding the ones that are there and powering them down slowly. We haven't dealt with the waste issue. We shouldn't be, but I would basically say, first of all, we need to power down. We as Americans waste so much energy. I mean, we could power down a third of our electric waste and become Europe with efficient appliances and efficient vehicles and building standards, you know, that without any change. And then the harder lift is the stuff that, you know, the idea that we're just, you know, decarbonizing aviation is not going to be that easy. We're just too mobile. We travel, you know, so there's going to have to be fundamental changes in our, whoever that is, Kyle, maybe go on mute there. Just a lot of noise. So we have to, you know, power down and use green sources carefully for the electricity, mostly electricity that we're going to be using. But we have so many immediately easy things we could do that don't require major sacrifices until we get to the, you know, to the harder stuff around limiting our vast amount of consumption.
Okay, Andy, you're next, and then we'll go to Ruth and then Dan and Lana. So Andy, go ahead. Louder, Andy.
Everybody hear me?
A little bit louder. Yeah, it's on. Just speak a little louder, Andy.
Okay. It wasn't mentioned so far, but I assume you've heard of it. There's an institute called Rocky Mountains, Colorado. They have a plan. They have offices around the world consulting with big companies. Just exactly what you're talking about, energy efficiency, powering down, teaching business owners that the future is all electric. And on the first page of the Rocky Mountains website, they have a graph showing how America can get to 2030 and stay on the 1.5 centigrade curve. Rocky Mountains is the East Coast Energy Strategy first. They were talking about some of the cars, but they're not for sale in America. One basic fact is that the question I have is, you have a good feel for it. I'm a third of the way through your book about red. I'd say to everybody, it's a fantastic book. Thank you for the reading. You gave one of the best environmental talks you've had in your years. I hope you'll come back soon about where we are as a nation, what we have to do. My question to you is simple. How fast do you think people in America might be getting to the point where raves, where more energetic demonstrations of some kind are needed to just shut down the plant?
Great question. And people should check out, as you mentioned, the Rocky Mountain Institute. I was in high school in 1977 when somebody handed me Amory Levin's Soft Paths to an Energy Future paper, which became the Rocky Mountain Institute. They, you know, if we had followed the advice of the Rocky Mountain Institute in 1977, we'd have a lot more options right now. We'd be in a really different situation. And that's the thing that we should remember is, the reason we didn't follow that excellent advice is because this fossil fuel industry blocked our ability to pursue a sustainable path. And my view is, my hope in writing a fiction is to engage a lot of people in this discussion who might not read a nonfiction book or go to a presentation about the Rocky Mountain Institute, but kind of on a human level are engaged. And I'm hopeful that we will rise to this occasion. We may not, you know, I think we can fight for a better catastrophe. It's too late to avert disruption. We need to prepare for a certain amount of disruption to our lives. And we have to think in terms of global solidarity. The people who are going to bear the brunt of this initially are in India and Pakistan in the next 2 months, and other places in the world that are going to have horrific heat waves. And that may be Chicago 1985 type heat waves, or I forget the exact year. But anyway, so, you know, I think that's where, but that will then trigger the consciousness, you know, in Kim Stanley Robinson's fictional book, The Ministry for the Future, which I recommend. The event that wakes up humanity is a horrific heat wave in India. And that kind of focuses our attention. And I think, you know, whether it's the coming hurricane season or heat waves or just harm to our food system, you know, all those things, hopefully will wake us up and we can push past the propaganda of the fossil fuel industry, who will happily have us all feel like, well, it's all of our fault. And we should say, yeah, we're all responsible. And you're 98% responsible for this predicament we're in, and we need to shut you down.
All right, Ruth, you're next. Go ahead, Nancy, ask your question.
Yeah, I love your book, Chuck. I just loved it. I remember all the things in my life, all the movements I cared about. I wasn't as involved as your heroine, but one thing, and I'm sorry if somebody's already asked about this, but one thing that the Rocky Mountain Institute, now called RMI, has been pushing and Rewiring America is pushing, is moving to electric appliances. And I know that you don't want to talk about, you want to talk about what local initiatives, but in the 2 years that the Bush administration, a current president has had a Congress, in the first 2 years, they passed the Inflation Reduction Act, and before that, the Jobs Act, Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, and there's major, major money for changing to electric heat pumps and electric appliances in your home. The average person can get $500, at least $2,000 a year for changing over to electric appliances. And heat pumps are selling very well in electric. Heat pumps are selling very well in Europe as they're trying to get off gas. Because of the dependency on, they're trying to get off the dependency on Russian gas. So the Sierra Club, Al Gore's Climate Reality Project, and all the major climate groups I know of are training people to get information out about the benefits available under the Inflation Reduction Act and the previous law that just squeaked through while we had this Congress.
So, question. I have a rebuttal period in a minute or two.
So would you recommend people go to Rewiring America and find out about those benefits?
I have a question for her before you get you next.
Great, great point. We should absolutely be doing this. The Inflation Reduction Act was, and the climate provisions, and there's a great example of what's possible when government isn't completely blocked, you know?
Right.
In fact, the original Build Back Better $4 trillion investment bill would have created kind of like Vista Peace Corps for environmental workers. And, you know, it could have gone even further. And that's the hope and possibility. So I agree. And we're getting heat pumps in our old rickety farmhouse here. We're trying to do the retrofit, take advantage of these tax credits. And people should look at, you know, Project Drawdown, the Rewiring America project, where we have some agency. You know, that's part of it, is like, we have some agency, we can do something in this space. It does make a difference.
There's gonna be jobs too. There's job training and jobs available for these new appliances.
Yeah. And for those of us who have young people at that stage of life where they're thinking about, you know, encourage people to go into those trades and into those careers, retrofitting and installing these new electrical systems and being part of, you know, there's a shortage of trade workers right now.
Yeah.
Join good unions and the building trades and retrofit all these old leaky buildings all over the country would make a huge difference.
Right.
Okay, you're next. Go ahead, grab the mic.
Just
pull it up to you and speak.
I heard that in Boston, they already have the gas terminals, but instead of shipping out natural gas because of the lack of pipelines, they were bringing in liquefied natural gas. And without all the pipelines, the oil is just moving on trains. And if you stop that, it'll move on trucks. It's going to get there one way or another. It's all a commodity.
Yeah, you know, what's fascinating is to watch the seesawing of the energy system. You know, we were importers of energy till 15 years ago, and then we became exporters of energy. Now we're importing some and exporting other, you know, but you're right in the sense you want to block infrastructure, but the energy is going to move. But you this whole idea of building permanent, you know, pipeline infrastructure for fossil fuels that should not be extracted. It's where, you know, we need to sort of resist in the capital R sense of that. So I think right now we're exporting gas.
No, we should not be blocking it. We should let it free movement.
Okay. All right. Dan and Lana, you got the next question. Dan and Lana, go
yeah,
ahead.
Okay, Tim, thank you. Thank you for your talk. It was very interesting. Maybe I'll read the book. But your characters, Ray and Roger, I think, maybe they belong to XR or 350.org. And so 200 years ago, there was a little bit of fossil fuel being taken out in 1820s. They were burning oil for heat. But anyways, so the leader of XR just got out of jail in England for about four. He was in jail for 4 months and for encouraging people to do civil disobedience, basically. And XR in England did block London Bridge in the morning rush hour, and cars were honking and people were mad, but people were happy too, I'm sure. So CEOs have pretty good security, I think. They're always at the top of buildings and many security people. So your character must know a secret trick to get into the CEO's office. Do you have any secrets that you know of that you want to tell everybody in the whole world today?
Nope.
Okay.
No, but I do think one of the results in England has been this criminal crackdown and criminalization of dissent. And I think that will inevitably come up. That's part of the collision between these forces. The fossil fuel industry is going to say, hey, we need protection, and we need new laws that say you can't protest against fossil fuel infrastructure and increase the penalties. That's already happening in a number of states around the U.S.
Right. In Atlanta, in the Cop City thing, there are people getting charged with something, developing. Anyways, they're getting charged 30 years is their sentence, possibly, for just.
Exactly.
So that's a red state thing, but thank you.
Thank you.
If you haven't mentioned this before, there's been a lot of stuff about AI, a lot of its hype, but has anyone used the new tools to ask, well, what's the best way out of this climate crisis?
Good question. He's mentioning artificial intelligence.
I don't have anything unique to say to that, so I would turn it to others in the room. Except I want to say one thing about my novel. There are no cell phones or high-tech solutions or gizmos. The technology we need to develop is how to live more simply with one another in community, practicing mutual aid. These are human technologies that and as well as regenerative agriculture. There's a lot we can learn about, you know, the fertility and stewarding what we already have. But I'm not enamored with all the techno fixes. And because it's my book, I get to leave them out.
Okay. Any more questions from the audience or online?
Let's thank our speaker then.
Let's thank our speaker then, because I know there's getting a lot of rebuttals in here.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for having me.
All right. The next thing we're going to do is I'm going to take the first rebuttal tonight. Because I think one of the things about climate change, you know, it's real. I know it's going to happen. It's just the solutions that we're looking at about conservation, about having a complete 100% renewable grid, about eliminating fossil fuels and protesting everything. You guys, I have a feeling, are nuts. If you're an environmentalist,
who's you guys?
And are not pro-nuclear, then the planet's doomed. You see, the thing is, a few years ago, almost 10 years ago, I found another source of power. And that is a small modular thorium molten salt reactor to the Thorium Energy Alliance. I did a deep dive into the study of it and do believe that that's going to be the way we have it. There was a novel out many years ago, not a novel, but a book out a few years ago by the author of a book by the name of Richard Martin. It was called Superfuel. And he talks about, you know, thorium-233 being converted to uranium-233, and through the use of a liquid-type fluoride molten salt reactor, which is basically about, will help eliminate nuclear waste by getting the long-term actinized, because you can burn these things up in it. Number two, renewables are simply not going to cut it. There's not going to be enough power. If you take a look at a website called the Roadmap to Nowhere, it thoroughly debunks many of the climatized solutions that renewables are going to do. You're going to need an area about the size of Nevada covered with about 70 stories of wind turbines just to get the energy output of the United States on a good day. And we can't handle that much construction. You can, though, with a small footprint, take a thorium molten salt reactor, put it into an existing coal plant, use that existing infrastructure, and still have on-demand power. The other point of the matter is that once you really look at this stuff and get rid of the misnomers and we get rid of some of the older technology of the type of nuclear reactors using now, the light water ones, you're going to find that there's a lot more different ways and better ways of using nuclear. The other thing you might want to consider is that, you know, you keep talking about all the fossil fuel industry shutting down and everything else. The thing is, the only way we're going to get out of it is introduce some form of alternative energy. Whether, you know, and the only way you're going to produce electricity, my friends, is through turbines and steam. And that's got to be done through a source of heat. That heat might as well be the thorium molten salt reactor, because that's the only way I see we're going to be getting out of this climate change and firmly getting off fossil fuels.
Just put solar panels on your house.
Well, Charlie, you know,
one full at a time, dude.
Solar panels on your house, Charlie, you might get 50% of your heat there. And what about those in an apartment building? I don't want to start arguing about this, because I'm still of the opinion, if you're not pro-nuclear and an environmentalist, we're doomed.
Here, here.
Okay, who's next?
Well, I got a question for you.
Well, go ahead. Okay, well.
Go
ahead, ask the question real quick.
No, Tim.
What about thorium molten salt rock candy?
Okay. No remote salt rock candy. Obviously, you don't know what I'm talking about.
July on
that. Anyway, let's get back to our next reporter.
Let's get back in order, please. Why are we not following the format?
We are following the format, Charlie. I just did my 3 or 4 minutes. Jonathan's next. So keep quiet. I'm not seeing anybody up online yet.
We the people are living our principles, building and preparing to transition to a justice imperative world, meaning justice teaching, justice practicing, justice protecting, justice reinforcing. A world structured in programs, services, and priorities that are livable and essential to the survival of living beings, people, animals, and the ecosystem. We the people are sick and tired of business as usual for what's profitable, for the super powerful, super influential. It's all that we know, all that we ever will know system. The question, is it really worth it, is the wrong one to ask. That's what the status quo, status quacks want our minds to think about. Instead, what we the peeps of planet E respond with is a naturally warm, tender, confident, what's not to love. Much to the speaking style and writing style of tonight's speaker, Chuck, who I appreciate being here. What love teaches us all is that movements that most motivate us to contribute our most genuine selves, share our most valuable gifts, are ones we love with such rare passion because they always love us back even more. They always deliver. No matter how much time, no matter how much energy or financial burdens and stressful headaches and aggravating heartaches or breaks that we endure along the way, no matter how many hoops we got to jump through to be there. Even when it costs us our reputations, always being perceived as ones who have permanently put the rosy-colored glasses over our vision, understanding of how it is, accused as somehow unreasonable and impatient, or perfectionists, or utopians who have somehow lost our way. Cynics and sycophants are fretting overtime to concoct fantastically ridiculous talking points for the airwaves and print waves so that ordinary everyday folks are never spared a single second from their echoing bullhorns, parroting the corporate bunker's official line that's desperately claptrapped by all the failed rulers who are held high up on their perfectly polished pedestals within the do-nothing departments. We need not pay any mind to that parade of propaganda. We know that grassroots global movements are exactly what we need. Where else can we meet so many new friends who make the world and how we always hoped it would be working together to create this consciousness, these voices, these actions, these responsibilities, and this civilization by our many skills we have learned over time are not dreams, they are in fact destiny. Those who mock and smear us are only in a rarely privileged position to do so because they inherited the all-time idiocy, foaming at the mouth every moment, only knowing how to bow down to the system's endless big ideas, which we know honestly are better described as no-dias. We the people of Mother Earth are welcomed into a beautiful world of we-dias because of our work, our contributions, our selflessness, our fearlessness, our cooperation, and our solidarity. When the naysayers attempt to force their doubt inside our thoughts, this frugal living we know, this humble existence we cherish, this ordinariness we embody, this gentle calling we are aware of as a mysterious yet oddly reassuring impact. And from time to time, when many of us say to ourselves, it hasn't been our day, it hasn't been our week, it hasn't been our month, it hasn't been our year or even our decade. Pause.
It's like Jonathan disappeared.
Jonathan froze.
Might be the whole Dappers connection there.
Okay, go ahead. And then we'll get Charlie next. Sorry about that. We had a little bit of a disconnection with the Zoom. We'll go Ellen, then we'll go Charlie, then we'll go you.
Okay.
All right, we're going.
Yeah, sorry about that. But that was, it was an excellent talk. And I really appreciate you and what you're doing. I like the idea of a ray, a person, and a historical experience that you prepared to there. It sounds interesting.
Not a relevant.
Especially if Andy Anderson likes it, I bet I'd like it. So I'll order it.
Okay, guys, hold down the noise, please.
I think what we need are solutions, and we need this free speech. We need the media to be deregulated again, or to be re-regulated, and so that the social media has to be fall under the regulations. It's this idea that a corporation, they get to remove people who don't speak to the party line, or don't fail to people have to be able to dissent and get to the truth. That's the way the dialectical process should work. I'm personally a teacher. I think we need to think like teachers and citizen journalists, citizen scientists, citizen people, and thinking about the planet and our grandchildren. I get disgusted. NPR is not regulated by the Federal Communication Commission. They will not, the other side of the story, masks and shutdowns and what are not the right solution. They won't say it. I mean, it's really scary times to have a state-sponsored censorship that, we thought that was just Russia in 1984. But the main thing is we have to, so people, I think it's like water. We can work around the, the blocks and the stupid and the evil. But recently I've heard this woman, Vandana Shiva, talk on Democracy Now. And she was so smart and positive. And I recommend you listen. She's got a book, Oneness Versus the 1%. Sounds brilliant, and she names the names of the Monsanto of this Democracy Now, and I'm like, thank you, because you feel like you're some radical crazy that has to do something just as
Monsanto, Pfizer. These companies were, I was an advertiser. You know, the marketing industry, if you look up what is marketing, it started in 1945. Its purpose is to, you know, Nazi take over the world, right? And they've got all the money and they pay the advertisers and the public relations people to lie and to cover up and to, you know, to minimize the threats to reality and civilization. And, you know, they're getting away with it. And it's like, you know, that's why I mentioned the Romero Institute. Danny Sheehan, who was, he had the Christus Institute and was actually, he's got a great public interest law, you know, nonprofit volunteers like us could be like the Romero Institute or the Christus Institute. Part of the reason they changed it is he was doing such a good job prosecuting the international criminal cabal. They, you know, they said he couldn't do it. You know, John Stockwell, the CIA defector, said, well, it's just so big, you can't fight it. But he, you know, he still is trying to, but, and then Romero Institute, I didn't realize that was El Salvador. They're still, they want to prosecute 9/11. And, you know, he says he just needs a few million dollars. I'm like, we could do that. We, you know, we've got to work together. I think it's a law. This is international criminal, you know, treason and, right, and war crimes. And I don't know why we can't seem to get the laws to work for us. And one thing, Tim, then think about, look at this bandana Shiva, because she also has this positive way that we assume, you know, you've got to have big oil and big farms and big, and that's the problem. I mean, go back to little farms and look at the movie Big Little Farm, you know, as this kind of diversity and seeds and, you know, they create the problem and then there's a reaction, you know, disaster, and they give us a solution. You know, more nuclear. You know, it doesn't have to be like that. That's a post 1940s idea. You know, let's just get the big guys out of there.
All right, Charlie, you're next. Then we go to Sid. Then we go to Justin. Okay, Charlie, you're next.
Yeah, let me get on. I hope everyone enjoyed the talk. I've got only three things that I'm going to talk about. I've been a lobbyist, serious lobbying efforts at the federal level for several decades on three issues. Yeah. It's an electing, trying to persuade candidates all the way from the electoral process, from candidates, campaigns, to elections, through developing legislation and seeing towards their passage and implementation. It may not be the most exciting way to do things, but it's the by far and away, without a doubt, the effective way of doing it. And in any operation, there's someone who is a deciding official. If you have a grievance, as I process them, we always say, who is the individual who can grant the remedy that you seek? It does have no value to influence or try to impact anyone else. Now, that may not be the most exciting route, a legislative route, but that happens to be the environment we live in. We are in a nation of laws. I just gave a talk the other day on the progressive movement, the second part, and I looked at how this was the period of the greatest social change in the history of our nation. And how did they achieve it at the time? How did the activists do it? In those days, they did not engage in violent activities. Certainly someone like Jane Addams and Mother Jones, they certainly were outspoken individuals, but they did not adopt any such strategies and yet were able to achieve the most significant social change ever evidenced in the history of the nation regarding public policy in many areas. What they always sought to do was to have the government create an institution or an element of government that addressed the problem that they were concerned with, and they succeeded in many, many times in that regard. To show you the extent to which they were influenced public opinion in the election of 1912 for president of the United States. All four candidates for president of the United States identified themselves as being progressives. That's how you do it. Another thing is, I recommend that the author and others look at Gene Sharp's book. I'm a secretary of the War Resisters League, and I'm certainly one who engages in protest, but there are 198 methods of protest. Not, and there's many altitude, and you have to do the one that conceivably, if you're going to do this road, go down this route, you select the one that's most appropriate. You do not want to open yourself up for criticism by the other side. And you've got to be cautious about getting negative opinions regarding your issue. And that is the potential danger behind all of this. Okay, and the third thing is, we heard once again, advocates of thorium, no such reactor, a piece of equipment exists anywhere in the world.
Yeah, oh, right.
The guy tells you,
one pull at a time.
If the guy, some guy tells you it does this or that, it's all fiction, like the book that guy wrote. It belongs to the fiction department of the library. It does not exist. There are problems. He went on it. Maybe perhaps you missed it. He said there are problems with nuclear which have not been resolved. I suggest you take care of that. We have a waste problem. Any sort of reactor, even thoriums, would be the radioactive materials for 400,000 years at the minimum. What do we do with this? And no, you have a problem. I wait to hear your solution to this. Okay, and that's about it. I hope you enjoyed it and come again next week to the college, everyone. Take care.
Right. Sid, you want to just stay right there? We'll grab the mic and bring it over to you. Just stay right where you're at. Okay. Somebody hand Sid the mic, please. Then we'll get Sid, then we'll get Justin, then we'll get you. All right, Sid, you got a few minutes. All right, Sid, you're up. You're on. Right into it, Sid.
About 8 years ago, this man was writing in a socialist magazine called Monthly Review, and he said that Germany, France, and some other countries will pull away from the United States and have its own separate ideas and programs and pull away from the United States. And one of the reasons that is happening is the pipeline that goes from Russia to Germany and these other countries. But that has been blown up. And the United States most probably moves pipeline up. But there's other aspects to it. And that is to sending tons of war materials to the Ukraine.
Yeah.
And who's the big one? Well, I believe what's happening is they're going to use neoliberalism to capture Ukraine from the United States. And the way they're going to do that is say, well, we sent you tons of weapons, and you now owe us trillions of dollars. So in order to get around that, what we're going to do is take over your brains and the things that people eat to make bread and to live on that. And that way, they'll capture. Yeah. But I don't think that'll happen. Eventually, Germany and France are going to pull away from the United States.
Okay, are you done, Sid? All right, Justin, we're going to get you next, and then we'll have our thing. So, Justin, go ahead, unmute, and you got the spotlight, Justin. You got to unmute, Justin.
All right. So, I'm not sure how to solve the environmental or climate crisis. I think we'll definitely need new forms of energy, but I don't think that, I fail to see how, you know, point A, wealth redistribution will lead to a better climate, point B. I would like to see that connection. But certainly we need interventions to prevent pollution, which is essentially trespassing and that sort of thing. I want to touch on something that Ellen Corley said. She said that she supports free speech, but then we need to have more media regulation. This to me sounds self-defeating. It's a contradiction. The purpose of free speech is so that there is no regulation of media. The government doesn't tell people what to say or what they can't say. Having things like the fairness doctrine is requiring, you know, which is requiring broadcasters to have equal time or whatever. I don't think that people should. I think that free speech applies to broadcasters. They don't want to have a point of view that they don't want to give a platform to. They certainly shouldn't have to. So this notion that you can have free speech but government regulation of media is a contradiction, and I don't get it. That's all. Thanks.
Okay, you're next, and let's get. No, you're just use the mic or the black one. Okay. Speak loud.
All right. As you know, Buck Binkley, I write under the name of H. Robinson. So, like the speaker, I have published a book.
A little louder, Doug.
I have published at least one book. Right. And I have written science fiction. One of the things I wrote in science fiction was a play in which the computer as a computer program is created by the captain of industry. I thought of Elon Musk before he was a personality, written back in 1989. So I brought up AI today as an indication from the play I wrote in 1989, in which I envisioned that possibly AI came about. But there would be a problem, of course. That problem is the ethicality of the AI. Didn't exactly use the word ethical AI in my play, but what happens is that this computer, as I envisioned it, by absorbing all the knowledge that humanity had, would actually become ethical. That would be logical. Now, what we have here is we have a combination of kind of a Wild West having this AI come online. In my play, the computer recognizes the danger, environmental danger, the coming future. So we're talking about around 30 years ago that I and many other people too envisioned that there would be a climate catastrophe or a climate crisis. Those are the two wordings we should use referring to the situation. But I hope that we can use AI as it develops in the next few years to come up with better solutions and that people will accept them. Part of the problem we have, free speech is mentioned. Free speech
is a great idea, but if it's not free to our society, in other words, if it causes great damage to our society, especially economic damage, like the insurrection that the Capitol did, then it's not really free speech. So we have to do, we definitely have to rethink that, especially if AI that's unethical is going to go against ethical AI. And if AI is going to be used by these corporations, they think the way the economy should stay green is to have it only to be concerned with the flow of money, because money's green. Mm-hmm. No joke there. But we need to have better systems for getting at the truth of what we need to do. And whatever will benefit humanity, including all those people along the equator that are suffering greatly now and will suffer more than us at the latitude we're at with the global warming continuing. I believe we can reverse the situation and humanity can survive, but we must do things right from here on.
Okay, Andy, you're next. Okay, Andy, you're next. You speak loud, Andy.
I'll be giving a talk here in 2 weeks.
And some of the things, louder, Andy.
I'm talking as loud as I can.
Okay, go ahead.
Could you turn up the volume on this? Can you hear me in the room okay?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll be speaking to the people in the room. There's a moment in a movie called In the Heat of the Night. Southern Sheriff. Rod Steiger, he thinks he has the character that murdered the richest man in town. One of the richest men. He says, I got the guy in jail. I got the body. I got the money he stole. I got the weapon. I got everything I need to convict him. Sidney Poitier, the detective, looks at him. He says, you got the wrong man. And he says, why? He says, Sam couldn't have driven 2 cars at the same time. The sheriff says, oh, that's a light bulb moment. Some people need to have a light bulb moment. Look at the current cost and reality. David Ray Griffin published 14 books on 9/11. But one of his professors sent him a videotape and said, David, you don't need an open mind to understand this. You need a 30% open mind and a 7th grade education. If you made it out of 7th grade, you can understand these facts. The problem is you have to look 30% open your mind and step through the barrier. You're living in a bubble. You're in a cult. You're a barrier. And the movie Spotlight is a teaching tool. It talks about how people step through the barrier and look at something they don't want to think about. Spotlight is about the pedophile priest problem in Boston and then worldwide. But people say you have free speech. Well, we have laws. You don't have the freedom to stand up and yell fire in a theater anytime you want and cost that business a bunch of money and create chaos. At the same time, European countries, many of them have laws that basically say, if you see fire in a theater, you are obligated to stand up and yell. If you see a crime in progress that's going to kill a lot of people, or even one person getting abused, and you don't do anything about it, that means consent. Silence means consent. That was pointed out by Sir Thomas More way back in the time of King Henry VIII, the English law. If I'm silent about something, it means that I agree with it. Well, silence means consent. We can't be silent on what's going on in our country anymore. And that's why the book that he describes, I'm halfway through it, it's a brilliant book. It describes why the Buddhist monks sat down during the Vietnam War and just immolated themselves, and why I think our country maybe where a few more people may start doing it. I hope not. The wild card, of course, is the army of young people, and as far as we can tell, not one of them has been killed yet. Nixon administration, they said that the National Guard just fire a few rounds into those students at Kent State, send them a message, and they'll stop their protest in Vietnam. Well, you fire a few rounds, you start killing people in seventh grade girls. Greta Thunberg's age, when she started protesting, one billionaire said, you kill one of those girls that are protesting for the future, and a thousand more are going to come right out of middle school and stand right where she was. There's an army of protesters, tens of millions of them. Students are out every Friday. I hear somebody expressing disgust about trying to face reality about what we're talking about. I'm not giving you any kind of opinion on anything. I'm giving you a summary of a massive database of published evidence from all over the world. If you want it in books, video, audio, any way you want it, it's mounted evidence. It's time to stop denying it. When you disparage speakers that are trying to enlighten people, then it's just not good. So college has been a free speech forum here for a long time. And I'm hoping that the college will be involved in the education of people with a couple of simple facts. Number one, it's 30 over 7. You've got a 30% over 9 with 7th grade education. You can understand that 1,000 times, it's not got 10,000 times more light falls on the planet every day than what the human race uses energy. We collect 1/10,000 of the solar panels. We don't need coal, oil, fossil fuel, or nukes, period. And before any small modular reactors can come online and make any difference at all, Miami's going to be under 10 or 20 feet of water. That's how fast it's happening. We've got until 2030. To avoid the irreversible snowball effect of the ice melting at both poles. And for those of you who aren't familiar with it, start logging on to Common Dreams every day. You look at the weekly articles that are published with pictures of the icebergs melting south of the Arctic. All the time the scientists are saying the computer models are wrong. The last 20 years of computer models are wrong. Yeah, they were wrong. They predicted this is going to happen a lot farther in the future than it's happening now. Every report that comes out week by week says it's happening faster. The damage is worse than anything. Now, Michael Mann just published the last article, and I'll try to get a copy for my speech in 2 weeks. At our current rate, we can expect about 60 meters of sea level rise. Well, that's 200 feet to Americans over the next 70 or 80 years, going back to what the world looked like when the oceans were 200 feet higher than what they are now. We haven't seen that in tens of thousands of years, but it's coming. It's possible, highly, highly possible, as we said. As our author said tonight, Chuck, people don't get their act together if they don't get alarmed enough. Shut the system down, shut the fossil fuel system down, and it's going to pretty much end. That's a trajectory. Not going to end by 2030. So all of you that's laughing about, oh, AOC said it's going to end by 20. She didn't say that. We are inundated by a flood, a total fire hose of right-wing bullshit, what I call criminally insane bullshit, crypt. Inundated by a flood of crypts 24/7 in this country. A third of our country is living in the bubble. Gotta get out of the bubble, people. If anybody is interested, I'm gonna give a talk like nothing I've ever given about current updated things that reporters can get fired for writing about that will change our country overnight. I invite everybody to come to in person. It'll be a lot better in person than it is on Zoom.
We can't hear you.
That's because he was talking low into the mic. Go ahead and go up.
No, he was talking right into the microphone. I could barely
Charlie, because he was very low.
No. I can listen very well. I'm still polite.
I'm taking a vote here. All in favor of an Andy Anderson hand pump?
And puppet. All right.
I'm sorry, Tim. I could barely hear what Andy had to say.
My name is David Travis. That's your calling card of charm. You should have started strong with that.
Instead of speaking like this, now I understand that microphone usage is around. We're trying to combat that problem. Charlie, it looks like our speaker may have logged off.
Thanks.
I don't know if I think he logged off. So if there's nobody else wanting to give a rebuttal,
I want to give a second.
Go ahead and come on up.
Yes. We want 100% rebuttal.
12 minutes, and then we'll adjourn. I wish our speaker would have been here to rebut everybody, but he obviously logged off.
He's from Vermont.
Without pipelines, the oil is just coming down the rails. And without rails, it'll come down the highway. The cancellation of the Keystone pipeline, all that did is all that oil is coming right through here on the CN, Canadian National. It's going to get there one way or another. Take your choose. And pipelines are safer and cheaper. It's going to get there one way or another.
Okay.
How about not using oil in the first place?
Well, Charlie, what are you going to do with the alternative right now? Who wants to go up there?
Hey, I can put some solar panels on my house. That's good.
All right.
I can do that next week.
You want to stick around? Go ahead and get up there if you want to speak. Yeah. We got a few minutes.
Just driving down the road in a super B train full of
water.
Yeah.
We are. We're going to.
Serious note.
Okay. Go ahead.
Serious note. I don't know. I came in late because of one of the problems we have in Chicago here, which at the time, maybe I will mention it. We have a mayor who's given a very mayor lightweight, as I like to call it, mayor lightweight. At least she's gone, but she still has a legacy, I guess it's called. Mayor Lightfoot did was give Brandon Johnson a hot foot, and maybe a bunch of hot feet, because I just got stuck in traffic. I'm getting here late. I gave myself an extra 15 minutes of what it usually takes when we get here on time. And I know I don't get here on time all the time, but I didn't expect an extra 45 minutes in the traffic because of this construction going on. And the other day I was coming on a Lakeshore Drive going southbound, and there was like literally 2 or 3 miles of cars backed up to northbound.
You could do that with Taylor Swift.
Just ridiculous. Most of these cars are still using gasoline fuel, so all of them that are stuck in traffic, unless they're turning their engines off continuously, they are just wasting more gasoline, creating more carbon dioxide fumes and other things. And it's just unbelievably terrible thing how badly our society is managed. One of the things we have to consider, though, we always have had to consider, but environmentalists don't usually bring up, I don't know if the gentleman did tonight, is how much carbon footprint it takes for all of these mitigation regimes, materials. So materials go in, to making the solar panels, for example, and for example, all of those windmills you see, they're offshore. The birds ate them using ultrasound or whatever. So that they're more environmental. If they use a large carbon, and of course, concrete is one of the most expensive in terms of carbon footprint of anything to construct. So there are people working on substitutes for concrete, for example. Hopefully, in a few years, that will be available on a larger scale if they don't get stopped. They don't start a movie Tucker about the Tucker automobile. It was filmed in 1945-46. Was trying to build a better automobile. Improved, actually. They were looking for the 50 of them before the big three, as they were called, crushed him. And it was just, I saw the movie again a second time. I hope that everybody takes a look at that. We are going to have a big fight like Tucker.
been on his hands, we're going to, even if we have a better mousetrap, it's a little
okay
problem. We're gonna have a problem with all of these
We're gonna get Justin again.
I could barely hear him.
Charlie, again, that was because we'll get that problem solved. You know, you can bitch all you want, but we do have a good mic. It's just that a lot of people don't know how to use it properly, and we will get more taken care of it. It's up.
For those who can't speak loudly.
Yeah, they could hear you, but you gotta project your voice. It's
Tim, someone.
Charlie, we're going
to. All right. Speaking from the podium just has to speak. That's all, Tim.
Charlie, we'll discuss this offline, okay? All right, Justin, go ahead.
Not working.
Go ahead, Justin, and we're going to do Sid.
All right, so if I'm going for rebuttal number two.
Just make it quick. We got about three, or we got to stop in about 5 minutes. So go ahead, Justin.
This is pretty much unrelated, I suppose, but something I'm just kind of peeved about. When people talk about globalists, and they talk about lizard people, or they talk about, you know, big banks and stuff, I think a lot of the times they're regurgitating anti-Semitic tropes, and it's really infuriating. And I don't think it does, you know, it doesn't help people. And if you're wanting to have a serious movement where you're trying to liberate people, I think it's kind of idiotic to use these dumb phrases, because people will hear these phrases in ways that, you know, other people might not hear them. And then next thing you know, your movement is full of anti-Semites or whatever. So people can just relax and refrain from repeating tropes like globalist or whatever. The world would be a much better place. Thank you.
Are we alive?
Start again.
And these are actually only about 10% of the world's population uses too much energy. They have their own private plane. They have their own private ship. They go places for vacation in different places where it takes them a lot of energy to get there. And they buy and buy and buy. They buy paintings. They buy things from the Orient and all kinds of things that nobody needs. And if we get rid of them, we get rid of global warming to a great extent.
Okay.
Can I say something?
Go, yeah, just make it real quick.
Also, regarding Justin's comment, you know, this idea of anybody talks about a globalist is talking about anti-Semitism. That's the trope. I mean, that's the thing. Just this week, the smartest guy, Sid Norit Baghdadi, who determined the actual harm of the spike protein, he has gone through a year of being called an anti-Semitic. He's the number one doctor in the world, and they go in after these people, but literally for being anti-Semitic. This is in Germany. But the judge would not allow them to talk about all the other people that were thrown off the internet for talking about the thing that, you know, the injection, the jab, the thing that you can't, if you say it, you're gone. Based on being anti-Semitic. That's globalist problem. Okay. It's not a conspiracy theory. Okay. There's a globalism problem, and it's the red nuts. Look at American intelligence media.
Okay.
These are not Jews. It is a conspiracy, a vast right-wing global conspiracy.
Okay. Jonathan will wrap it up and adjourn us when we're done.
Yeah, I'd like to say something, Tim.
All right, Charlie, go ahead.
All right. I've heard some things here about censorship or accusations of censorship. Let me get my screen up. One second here. Why won't it come on?
Probably a local.
There you go. Oh, I heard this thing. It's about censorship all the time here. Enough is enough about this. If I write an article in which I make the assertion that the moon is made of green cheese. Now, Astronomy Magazine.
You made it eight?
Astronomy Magazine will not publish my article. And then they claim, oh, there's censorship. And then they say, well, I say, nobody believes me. They must not be, there's something wrong with the people because they're not accepting my message. They don't believe me either. So there must be something wrong with them. And then they go to, they want actually, just to get on this, they actually want to go to the government of the United States and pass a law that the media outlets of the United States have to broadcast my theory that the moon is made of green cheese. Yes. And then they dug it out a little bit. I'm not certain if the field of astronomy is advanced, yes, in any way, fashion, or form, or we might be misleading using our resources to try to establish whether or not the moon is in fact made of green cheese. But you've got to ask yourself, why am I advancing? Am I advancing an argument that's credible? Does it have credibility within the standard community? Now, you come up with conspiracy theories because you claim that people do not listen to your article or believe your article. Well, perhaps your article's deficient. Have you ever considered that? The news media outlets of the United States are not, and I hope they never will be, obligated to broadcast misinformation, disinformation. If you have not been able to convince the people of the United States in any way, shape, or form,
all right,
that the government is not obligated to correct that situation. That's all. Thank you.
All right, Jonathan, go ahead.
Thanks, Charlie.
I just wanted to suggest this article by Chris Hedges. It's from a talk he gave on April 4th of this year, 2023, at the Independence National Convention. It's called Reclaiming Our Country by Chris Hedges. It's very direct to what the speaker talked about this evening. Read the article by Chris Hedges, Reclaiming Our Country. That's my suggestion for this evening. I wish I could have made more copies for folks who are here. It's really good.
Okay, Jonathan, take us out and adjourn us, please.
Thank you for coming this evening. See you next week, Saturday at 5 p.m., hopefully in person.
Adjourn.